The thoughts and opinions of this program are merely those of the guests and the hosts of the program. You're listening to The Good, The Bad, and The Rooster. I'm Jimmy Olsen. Welcome to the show once again. Rooster, how are you, sir?
Doing great. Had a great weekend. What are you slobbering on yourself for? You had to wipe your mouth when you were talking. You haven't. Are you still?
I'm still salivating from the bike ride, the 12-mile bike ride I did yesterday, so I'm still trying to get my breath back.
Well, you tell me about a 12-mile bike ride, and I'm tired just hearing it.
Well, then I ran.
I need to take a nap now.
I even ran on Saturday, too.
You ran?
I ran.
From who?
No one. Actually, I'm mentoring.
Last time I ran, some guy was trying to chase me down because I stole his bicycle.
I did a No Boundaries program with a local store here, Fleet Feet Sports, and over the East Village here in Des Moines. And so in the summer, I was actually a participant, but this time I'm a mentor. So I'm there helping other people and kind of running with them and kind of helping them along.
How far can you run?
I've done a 5K. That's the most
I'll
ever.
The whole way.
Yeah, I ran the whole way. Yeah, I'll never do more than that because
seriously, youth is lost on me because I'm an old fart. I wouldn't make it a tenth of a mile.
You know, for me, it's just all. You know, and the funny thing is, I'm probably in better health now, and I'm 100 pounds heavier than what I was in high school.
Really?
And of course, I've lost. I mean, we've had the conversation before because I've lost 80 pounds.
Yeah, you lost 80 pounds for crying out loud.
Yeah, a few years ago. And of course, now I'm still kind of losing. It's kind of like that whole up and down thing. You never know what it is.
Yeah, I know how that is. I've lost maybe 5 pounds in the last few weeks because of finally dealing with my diabetes.
Mm-hmm.
Finally taking, you know, doing the right diet and that type of thing. And it's making a difference. I mean, I did my little test this morning and finally broke under the 100 mark. On my what do you call that? That test for diabetes. You know what your blood sugar level is.
Mm-hmm.
2 weeks ago it was 276. So just to let you know how high. I mean, that was bad. So
right.
So you know, listen, I think that's great that you can go out and do that. And maybe one of these days I will before I get too old.
Well, and it's one of the thing is you're never too old to start trying to get in shape again and just trying to clean things up a little bit again as we get older. It goes back to the whole savings thing, which we've talked about, thanks to a debt prodigy and doing the program. But it's the same thing. It's saving when you're young. You don't even think about it. It's not important. Just like your health. It's not important. Insurance. I don't need insurance. I'm not going to go to the doctor.
Yeah, yeah.
But as we get older and we start thinking things through, it's a completely different story.
Yeah,
wait a minute.
Your mortality hits you square in the face when you start seeing friends die around you.
Well, that or all of a sudden, in high school, you're just kind of automatically a little more healthy because you're more active. But then, one day you go to, stand up and walk to the, kitchen to get a beer and you had to stop for 2 seconds and get your breath. And you're like, well, wait a minute. There might be
your own health. And that's what's happened to me in the last several years is I looking at my own health, the diabetes and the high blood pressure, all that crap that old farts seem to get. But I have to pay attention to it now. And I have to admit, I hate it. Mm-hmm. I hate it because I go, my 20s, 30s and 40s, this was never an issue.
Right.
Now, yeah, it's an issue.
And
you have to pay attention to your health, folks. I mean, at the end of the day, if you do what you need to do to live longer and live a more productive life, you should do it. I don't sit around eating rice cakes all day to stay healthy. I mean, I'm not going to eat cardboard to stay healthy.
It's called moderation.
Yeah, moderation.
Let's be honest. I mean, the thing is, it's not like my parents taught me this. My parents never told me. You know what? I'm sorry. That's where it starts.
Well,
it starts in the home. It starts when you're a child.
Sure.
If you're a parent, take some responsibility.
Sure.
And say, kids, we need to be healthy.
Oh yeah,
and show them and be that example.
I've got one of my daughters that she's a vegetarian,
mm-hmm.
and she has taught one of our granddaughter her firstborn child. This kid will sit down and eat veggies all day long. She loves them. She loves in the garden. She's pulling stuff up and eating it right out of the garden. What 6 year old do you know that loves sushi, loves fish?
Right.
But she loves that stuff and eats it.
Mm-hmm.
And it's because Tony wants to make sure that she lives a healthy and clean and healthy a lifestyle as possible. And this kid is, let me tell you what, you talk about energy. Most kids have tons of energy.
Mm-hmm.
This kid's got tons of energy times 10.
Right.
I mean, and she's in great health. She's not a chubby little child. Mm-hmm. I mean, she was chubby because she had baby fat, right?
Yeah, we all had that. But at some point, you're going to grow out of that.
She grew out of that. She's looking great, and she will probably stay that way because, again, getting back to your point, the parents have led the charge to mm-hmm. have the children eat healthy. When we were kids, and especially I know when I was a kid, and if you're out on the farm too, there's a little bit of a difference, but we were taught if you put it on your plate, you eat what's on your plate.
Mm-hmm.
Okay?
Right.
You know, when I lay it there, and the standard, I think somebody got a manual. All the parents got a manual. When your kids don't eat, tell them, think of all the poor children in Africa, right? I mean, I can remember my mom, think of all those poor children in Africa that don't have any food to eat, and look what you have. Well, send the damn food to Africa, okay? If you feel that bad about it, package this crap up and send it to them.
Right.
I love my mama, but there was things that I would not eat.
Right.
I would sit all night and was ready for butt blistering, was salmon patties. Them suckers sucked, okay? And her mashed potatoes. Hated it.
Mm-hmm.
Then the third thing was when she would make peas.
Okay.
God seriously took a vacation that week. Seriously took a vacation. I mean, peas are the nastiest vegetable, especially when they're prepared old school. Old school is let's put it in a pot and cook it till it's dead twice.
With butter.
Oh, yeah. Well, lots of butter. Lots of butter. Or bacon grease and all that. But cook them. I mean, vegetables when I grew up had to be cooked, you know, until they were dead twice.
There was no crunch.
It
was mush. Yeah.
Just mush and nasty tasting. So yeah, health-wise, congratulations to you on having the drive and the determination to go do an exercise and ride a bike like that. I applaud you.
Yeah,
I do.
I tell myself that every day.
Yeah, that's fine. And I will wave to you as I see you go by and say, Reverend Jimmy, have a good day, as I'm on my Harley doing 55 miles an hour, relaxed and cool and doing fine. All right, fine.
It's all good. You listen to The Good, the Bad, and the Rooster. Thanks to Debt Prodigy, the world's first interactive and web-based financial tool that virtually puts your home and business finances on autopilot. Details at debtprodigy.com. And you can be sure to put in there that Jimmy Olsen was your reference, so that way Rooster and I get credit for you checking that out. And again, thank you for the opportunity that we're here from the DebtProdigy.com studio.
Absolutely, absolutely.
The Good, the Bad, and the Rooster. Chevy Chase, he entered rehab. Did you hear about that?
I heard that. He's good for a tune-up. Yeah, where do they come up with that crap? Yeah, I'm a drunk. Got to come in for a tune-up. Well, who gets a damn tune-up for drugs? And alcohol. How did that doesn't
mean? Right, because he said, well, I guess he was at Betty Ford back in the mid-80s because
right.
He had a painkiller addiction. But yeah, tune-up, I don't know.
Maybe I don't understand the terminology.
He's getting, well, it's California, so maybe he's getting an enema.
I don't even, what?
Clean
what,
out?
Yeah, I guess.
You know.
I get. Well, and here's, serious. Okay, I don't want to go down that road. Let's get, Chevy, you funny guy, but your time has passed.
Steve Harvey, remember when he botched the whole Miss Universe pageant?
Yeah, I love Steve Harvey.
The Philippines are wanting him to be replaced because of messing that up. But of course, you know, good luck with that since he did sign a 5-year contract.
Seriously.
He's going to be there for a while.
I get it. You got to be a professional in that. But that was just freaking funny.
Yeah.
How much press has this produced for that show?
Right. Absolutely.
Because he made a mistake.
Well, now, was it him reading it wrong? I thought they actually gave him. They wrote it.
Could be.
It doesn't matter.
Could be. Doesn't matter.
Whoever's in the front
wrong.
Of the camera. Yeah, whoever's in front of the camera, you're the one that's going to get the blame, no matter where it came from.
It kind of goes. Let me say this real quick. Mm-hmm. I'm watching this series, Harley and the Davidsons. If you're not watching, it's on Discovery Channel. Started last night. Kind of a 3-night miniseries. Being a Harley rider myself, I found it interesting because I like documentaries anyway. And one of the Davidsons, brothers is just a real promoter. I forget the first name, doesn't matter. And this lady from the newspaper came in to his office after they had got some investors in it. You know, they had their little factory in Milwaukee. And as she walked in, he introduced himself, says, "Man, it's nice to see you." And he reaches his hand out to shake her hand, and she didn't raise her hand. And the reason, first of all, for you etiquette people, gentlemen, you wait until a woman extends their hand, then you extend yours. That's a little rooster information. That's proper etiquette. Just letting you know. And a little old school ain't bad. But anyways, he still did it. He still put his hand down. She went. She said, "You may not want to shake my hand after you hear what I want to talk to you about. I'm writing an article about these killer machines. You're going to kill people because they go too fast." I mean, so she went down this little road and all that. And Davidson, being the promoter of this, I just love this. He went, "That's great. That's wonderful. I'm glad to have you here." And she has this dumbfounded look on her face. And he said, "Look," he said, "I don't want you to stop writing these articles because this is press. People are hearing about it. Please continue." He said, "And don't ever ride one of our motorcycles." And she went, "What?" She said, he said, "Yeah, because you're going to love it so much, then you're going to write the wrong article. Keep doing what you're doing." That's clear. Bad press is good. Let's turn this table one more time. The little bastards that are out there talking about Trump, he's terrible. He's awful.
We'll get to Trump.
All right. I'm jumping ahead.
You yelled at me about that earlier, so stop jumping ahead.
All right, I'll jump.
All right. Well, actually, we do have something about that.
Reverend.
You're gonna like our little Trump Hillary thing. Anyway, all right. So here's something. NBC, remember Oliver Twist, the hungry boy, you know?
Yes, I have read a book before.
So can I have some more?
I know I'm a hillbilly.
They're going to redo it.
Really?
They're going to redo it. It's going to be more sexy, more contemporary. So they're going to have, I guess it'll be a woman in her 20s, 20-something, who will be the leader of the group of outcasts. They're going to take down the wealthy criminals.
Oh, good Lord.
Excuse me, sir. Can I have some more?
More pudge for me? Oh, good Lord. You know what? Remakes of movies or books. Seriously. To me, to all you folks that are going, "Oh, this is going to be great." You're idiots, okay? Here's the deal. That's stupid.
I look at it this way. I mean, at this point, everything they're doing in Hollywood is a remake of something.
They're regurgitating everything. Remember when they came out with True Grit, the second one?
Right.
Okay, seriously, I was excited. I'll be honest with you. I was excited because I'm a John Wayne fan. Mm-hmm. And I even liked the actor. Who played Rooster on that one?
Bridges.
Yeah, Jeff. Jeff. Was it Jeff Bridges?
Yeah, it was Jeff.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. And I like him. Mm-hmm. Seriously, I do.
Because he was also the Big Lebowski.
Yeah, dude. Yeah, I mean, I like him as an actor, but I felt that movie sucked. I have no idea what it did in the box office. I really don't care.
Well, and actually, that one followed truer to the book than the original with John Wayne, because the original with John Wayne had the happy ending, which the book, died or whatever it was. Oh, did I give it away?
You gave it away.
Sorry. Anyway, but it actually followed the book truer than what the original.
But seriously, I'm a purist when it comes to a John Wayne movie.
I guess I look at it this way. I mean, because even in the 80s, they were going through a time where Hollywood was remaking a lot of stuff. But they were remaking stuff that was stuff I didn't know about.
30s and 40s stuff.
Right. I mean, really old stuff.
Which is okay.
To where now they're redoing stuff that people remember.
Yeah. And
like Ghostbusters. I mean, Ghostbusters was 80s.
Yeah.
30 years ago.
Yeah. Why? I don't see why we would do that, because it just really screwed. Look at the actors that were in the original Ghostbusters. One or two of which. I forget his name.
You had Ernie Hudson. You had
He's still alive.
You had Bill Murray. You had still Dan alive. Aykroyd, and then you had
what's his last name starts with an M? Honey, I Shrunk the Kids.
No, there's Rick Moranis. But he was in it, but he wasn't one of the original.
He wasn't the Ghostbusters.
Right.
It was Zemeckis.
No, I know him. Who you're talking about. But and you're right. He did because he was away. He was actually well. He was also one of the directors.
Yeah.
And,
yeah.
Man. can. It is. It's totally at Kirby, please.
Kirby, find that for us.
Totally,
well, let me give...
Because he was also part of the group with Caddyshack.
That's... Oh, yeah.
Harold Ramis.
Ramis.
Yes.
Ramis. Yeah.
Harold Ramis.
Great yeah. guy.
Well, it takes a while.
But here's... To take this and not get carried away, here's the movie that I'm looking for.
Mm-hmm.
It's remake.
Mm-hmm.
But the reason I'm excited about the remake is who the lead actor is,
okay.
Denzel Washington. They're remaking The Magnificent Seven. Do you remember The Magnificent Seven?
I did see that. Yeah,
Based upon the book, The Seven mm-hmm. Samurai.
Right.
Okay.
Right.
So that was the Yul Brynner.
Mm-hmm.
And then they did a second one with Yul Brynner.
Mm-hmm.
And then they did a freaking third one and just demolished the whole deal.
It sucks.
Right. I mean, it just sucked. The second one was, but the first one was it. I mean, here's the other, the music, everything. Mm-hmm. I'm going to reserve any comments. I'm going to watch it because mm-hmm. I am a huge, huge Denzel Washington fan.
Mm-hmm.
So this is a remake.
I think a lot of times it depends on the writing and how it actually is, how it's directed.
Yeah,
I think
it's a combination of those things. Now, mm-hmm. the other thing that I'm looking for is this isn't a remake. This is a series.
Mm-hmm.
Did you watch Denzel Washington? Listen, this guy's great. He's got a new movie coming out where he plays Sully, you know, the pilot.
Oh, Tom Hanks.
Oh, that's Tom Hanks. Wrong guy.
Right.
Isn't it Monday morning? Is this Monday morning? Oh, it's Tuesday morning. Oh, crap. Where am I? Aren't I supposed to be at the dentist right now? Now, Denzel did.
That's me Friday.
Yeah, Denzel did that, but he did a movie, maybe 2 years ago?
He did do a movie that he was.
Equalizer.
Oh, yeah.
The Equalizer.
From the TV show.
And I love the little British guy that played in it. He was so dapper and cool. Loved the Jaguar.
And this was a little different because, because back then, he had the Jag. He lived in the house. And where this time, Denzel worked at, like, Home Depot,
yeah.
There
is an example. I was okay with it.
Mm-hmm.
But again, it was because it was off of a TV series that constantly changed. So the Equalizer, you're right, lives in a little apartment. His wife is dead.
Mm-hmm.
And the other thing that he's ADD.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, all through this movie, he's ADD. And what I mean by ADD, or is it ADD? No, that's not right.
ADHD?
What is it? No. When you have to have everything.
OCD.
That was it. OCD. Sorry, folks. Look, I told you I'm from the hills of Tennessee. He's OCD. Mm-hmm. Did you ever notice that? I mean, when he's ready to wipe out a whole room, 28 seconds. That's okay. Killed six people. 28 seconds. That's okay. He's OCD. Everything had, his napkin had to be right. His coffee cup had to be. It was just, again, what a fascinating actor because mm-hmm. he has to get into that. Anyway, enough of that stuff. So I'm looking forward to The Magnificent Seven
mm-hmm.
to see where that goes. I'm with you on that.
All right. So a couple more things before we get into a few more meat. Hall & Oates, they got a star on the Hollywood Walk of Fame.
I'm okay with that.
Yeah.
I'm okay with that. I like those. They had some really cool music.
Freddie Mercury, 70 on would have been 70, and for his 70th birthday, if he would have lived, named a asteroid after him. Freddie Mercury, a queen.
I don't have a problem. That's funny. But it's kind of cool.
An asteroid named after him.
An asteroid. You do know that you can get a star named after you.
Well, yeah. For 1990, I don't know.
Yeah, yeah. Mrs. McRoberts has the Belinda K star.
Yeah.
I did that our first anniversary. I did that. Wasn't that sweet? Dadgum sweet. Yeah, all you people out there think I'm a prick. I'm a nice guy, okay?
You're listening to The Good, The Bad, and The Rooster. Thanks to Debt Prodigy. Debt Prodigy helps you track all your spending expenses, create and manage your budget, manage all your financial account, and Debt Prodigy can show you how to get out of debt, including your home, in the shortest amount of time. Details for that, debtprodigy.com. Sign up, and they'll keep you up to date with how things are going, and be sure to reference Jimmy Olsen when you're in there so Rooster and I get credit for you checking it out, debtprodigy.com. Again, it's The Good, The Bad, and The Rooster. Okay, so you started talking about Trump. I put some brakes on that.
Yeah,
okay.
You kiboshed me.
But we're going to have that conversation now.
We are?
But see, the thing, because
I've been allowed to talk about something else now. Thank you, Rev.
But here's the twist on that, because you were talking about Trump.
Twist, all right.
And, I was reading this in the Des Moines Register this morning, maybe it was over the weekend, and they were talking about Hillary and Trump wondering if they were going to be able to basically stay on track, pick up more steam during this election. Because number one, I mean, okay, let's be honest. We've been sick of elections for years, but this one is just even more so.
Yeah.
So it's kind of the question is, you know, where they are now, are they going to be able to pick up more steam, or is this kind of just where it is? Now, I thought this was funny. The creators of South Park, Trey Parker and Matt Stone. Did you ever watch? I'm sure you've heard of it if you haven't watched it.
I watched South Park a couple of times. Bunch of idiot little jerks in that thing.
You're going to love this. They really do not care who is elected. Either one, Trump or Hillary, because both will be great for comedy. In fact, this is how Parker even added to that. He goes, it's like choosing between a giant douche and a turd sandwich.
Who's the douche and who's the turd?
I'll leave that up to anyone listening, and you figure it out on your own. But I mean, and
Ms. Kirby, who's the douche and who's the turd?
She's the turd. He's the douche.
That would have been where I'd gone. Yeah, probably. I'd gone that way. Yeah, I'd gone that way. I mean, and now we're getting this the lesser two. Look. Here's the thing. First of all, who's going to pick up steam? I don't know if I'm 100% accurate on this number, but it's so the number's so small, I'll be close. Mm. When less than 40% of the population, and it might be closer to 20%, don't even vote. Okay? That's the first problem in this country.
Mm-hmm.
And whoever you want in, you need to at least vote. And vote your conscience, but further vote the real facts as you see them. Okay, that's the first thing. So I think if we were to look at these numbers, keeping that in mind, based upon, I don't know if these are truths or not, but based upon the numbers that Trump has pulled, okay, in his events and rallies, compared to Hillary, who's brought good numbers in at times, but we talked about this several shows back at the Republican convention. The Democratic convention. Sorry, guys, Democratic convention where they had seat fillers. They were paying people to go in there, keeping the Bernie people out. Based upon I do not know if this is facts, so don't beat me up after this. Where they're paying people to be in these rallies. When she's reading to kids in schools, she has to be paid to go do that. It makes me think that as we get closer to, November 8th, that I think that you're going to see, and I think I said this several shows back, I think you're going to see a bump for Trump. That's a rhyme, wasn't it? Let's get a bump for Trump.
Pulled that right out of his rump.
My wazoo. I'm telling you. Look, seriously, I think these polling companies are all, if you look at the numbers, they're all pretty dadgum close.
Well, that's the thing.
As I told you several weeks ago, I think there's something to these poll companies. They're just kind of keeping the status quo with their numbers. So there's two issues. Keep the status quo. Two, less than 40% of the people even vote. So how many are they really polling to get those percentages? And I think that as we get closer, and I think going into the first week in October, second week in October, and let's watch and see if I'm right. Mm-hmm. I think you're going to start seeing a spread develop. And I think that Trump will take the lead. And let me tell you why I think Trump will take the lead.
Rooster, you tell us.
I want to tell you exactly why I think he's going to take the lead. First of all, Hillary is a despicable human being. Even the Democrats that are hard party individuals know that she's a putz and a complete
turd.
There you go. She's the turd. Okay. She's the turd. And they look at this and go, we know the foundation's stolen. We know that money's been stolen. We know that. And they know she is a turd, a piece of turd. She's not even a full piece of turd. She's just a turd, you know, and she's terrible. Trump, on the other hand, is Trump. And so having said that, a lot of people, even in her party, have shied away from her. When they talk about how people in the Republican Party have shied away from Trump, the same is true of Hillary and her party. They're shying away from her because she's a problem. I predict that if she loses, her little butt's in trouble. I mean, Donald Trump is a big enough douche, okay? He's going to sick people on her and put her ass away and not blink. And so I think in this country, I think Trump is going to win. He's going to win based upon where, hope and change of Obama's gone. He says he wants to make America great again. I think the real reason that we're going to vote for him and put him in is because he is a take no prisoners. I don't give a crap. He's standing on the podium in Mexico. And there isn't anybody can deny this. I watch my Facebook feed and all my libtard friends. Nobody made a comment because he was presidential in the way that he handled himself. Folks, think about that. He was presidential, and he was not afraid to say, we are going to build a wall. There is a problem here. Now, whether he builds the wall or not is not the point, but he has put them on notice. We recognize the problem, and we're going to do whatever it takes to solve the problem. Even where the president or prime minister of Mexico turned around, and he was pretty tough too, okay, and said, yeah, but. So he was able to, did Hillary go down there and talk to him? No. Has Obama gone there? Guess what? He told him, the Philippine president told him to take a flying flip because he was trying to tell the Filipino president how to run his country. And he said, this ain't your country. Who do you think you are? You know? So in other words, I think Trump will get in because he's not afraid to stand up to anybody. He does not care about old school, what we know now as diplomacy. Here, let me stroke your little ass to make you feel good. Okay? He's going back 50, 75, 100 years to the way that our presidents and our leaders used to handle this country. You cross the line, I'll kill you.
They did, because he even got criticism from, I mean, I know you were saying on Facebook there were no mentions on that, but I was watching some news.
I didn't see him.
Yeah. But they were saying how he was being... They, in some ways, and I can't really remember exactly what it was, but in a lot of ways, what the media was saying is that he was in Mexico saying this, which means he was being disrespectful, and they couldn't believe that he would go over there and act that way. On
Trump?
Yeah.
Well, where does that even come from? I mean, act that way. What is that way? You know, people always make these broad statements. We can't believe he acted that. Disrespected who?
The Mexicans. Mexico.
Here's the deal. Let's cover that little problem of respect and disrespect. I covered that on Facebook sometime back.
Mm-hmm.
Look, is it disrespectful for me to disagree with your opinion? Is that disrespectful?
No.
But whenever you post a disagreement to Obama or Hillary, you're always going to you get these feedback. How dare you talk about that? I got a black friend of mine. Love him. Well, I don't understand. You're disrespecting Mr. Obama. I ain't disrespecting him. I don't agree with the little prick. Okay? I respect the office that he has been voted into, apparently, by the vast majority of the electoral college, right?
Mm-hmm.
So he went through the system, and he was voted in. I am so sorry. There's a bunch of dummies out there that did that, but the fact of the matter is we did. He is our president. If I walked into the White House today, I would show him respect for the position that he holds. If he were to ask me, what do you think about my position on whatever?
Mm.
If it were a subject that I disagreed with him on, I would say, Mr. President, with all due respect, I think that that's silly. I don't agree.
Right.
Now, people out there, they play the two cards, the one disrespect card. Well, you're disrespecting. No, I'm not disrespecting anybody. Okay? I'm not. I am taking a position where I don't agree. Am I disrespecting? I don't like rap music. I don't like rap music. Right. I think I just don't like it. And it may be because I don't get it. Am I disrespecting a famous rapper by saying I just don't like his crappy music? No, I'm just taking a position of agreeing or of saying that's not my, doesn't suit my taste.
Speaking of disrespect and taste, we'll get right back to that because that's going to roll us right into our next subject we want to do. But first, you're listening to The Good, The Bad, and The Rooster, Debt Prodigy. Thanks to Debt Prodigy, the world's first interactive web-based financial tool that virtually puts your home and business finances on autopilot. DebtProdigy.com is where you want to go for more details. And while you fill out the form there to have them kind of keep you updated as they're getting things rolling, you want to put in there as referred by Jimmy Olson to give Rooster and myself credit for that. But as we move forward, again, Rooster's talking about the whole respect and disrespect thing, and we talked about this not in the show the last time, but we kind of actually forgot about it, and it's still being talked about, and that's now, it's Kaepernick, right? Is that
how you pronounce his name?
Kaepernick. Okay, so Colin Kaepernick.
Yep.
And I know with what happened, you were a little... Your feathers were ruffled with his protests that he was doing. Now, here's the funny thing, because speaking of about no bad press. So since he started doing his little silent protest to the national anthem, his jersey sales have soared. Yes.
Seriously.
People are burning them.
And
Ms. Kirby said, well, sure. People are burning the damn things. I agree.
And then, of course, President Obama said protests can be messy, but that's how democracy works. Well, there's two.
This has nothing to do with democracy.
So do we know now the reason why, and I could be wrong, but if I'm remembering right, the reason why he's doing the silent protests is because of the violence that's happening in our country. I mean, that is the reason that has been given. So I'm going to ask you two questions.
Here we go.
Well, I mean, and number one, it is a free country. I think, you know, us being able to protest if we do not agree with someone, which we just talked about agreeing, not agreeing. I mean, that's how we are being of a free mind, of being able to think for ourselves.
I understand that.
But the question is, when you are, so last week, I remember you basically ranting about this guy who is just disrespecting the military by not standing up, and the country, by not standing up for the national anthem. That is all you said. Did you know why he was having his little protest?
Didn't care. Okay. I clearly didn't care, but it all leads back to America has perpetuated, I believe, as I recall reading, has perpetuated this this racist attitude towards the black community.
Mm-hmm.
And he was saying, I don't want to acknowledge a country that's allowed this to continue. Yet, at the same time, he's willing to take the money from big corporations to pay his damn salary. And by the way, folks, who the hell cares about this little prick? He's not even a first-string quarterback. I mean, he's a worthless ball player. He's not even first string, as I understand it. Okay? He's not the first guy on the line. But what I'm trying to say, let me get back to that, is the fact that he's trying to tell people, I'm in disgust of the way the black people treat it. Let me tell you what, I can give you just as many white people been mistreated as our black people mistreated. And I think that, like, let me read something to you.
Well, I was going
to
say,
go ahead.
So that was my question, though. So he's making his protest, his stand, and by doing that, people are getting irate over what he's doing because I don't care if I read something that, you know, he knows, you know, vets, he has friends that are vets. He's went and talked to them.
Have you ever heard the guy that says, I'm a white guy and you're racist? I got black friends. What's that mean? That's disrespectful, in my opinion, to make that statement.
The question comes to, so like you said, you didn't care. It was beyond the fact. So
if I'll tell you why in a minute.
If you're going to protest, you to me, if you're actually wanting to make a stand, if you're wanting to get people's attention, why would you do something? I mean, I would assume in his mind he would know by doing this, he's going to create offense and offend people.
Mm-hmm.
At that point, how are you going to get them to see your point of view? Because you have offended them, torqued them off. So they're just going to say, you know what? I really don't care what you think or say because
it was the wrong platform. At the end of the day, it was the wrong platform. Let me read a post that I made.
Okay.
Can I do that?
Yeah.
I said, I'm going to weigh in on this subject to Colin, how do you pronounce this?
Kaepernick.
Colin K., as we'll call him. When someone does something good for you or provides you a favor, even as small as opening the door for you, your positive reaction is to say what? Thank you. Right? Isn't that what you should do? Right? That is if you haven't been raised in a barn. Okay? Obviously, I'm sorry. I believe he was adopted. And I...
Two white parents.
White parents. Isn't that something? Does he think his mama and daddy are bad people? I bet they're proud of him right now. Now, we still live in an awesome free country that the blood of many have been spilled for each of us to enjoy those freedoms. Sure, we aren't perfect. We have our own faults. On a personal and national level, we are all flawed in some area, but we are still in a great country for which I'm proud. Rooster's proud. I'm proud. We should be proud of this country, regardless of what anybody thinks. I just lost my spot. Those freedoms extend to each of us, freedom of expression and speech. This last week, Colin exercised, and again, this was a post, Colin exercised his freedom to not recognize our or his country's flag or anthem. That is or was his right, but here's where he went wrong. He squarely spit in the face of those that have opened the door for him. Hence my reason I talked about the door opening. He disrespected their memories past and those that are not protecting not only him, but all of us now and the future. He spit on my flag and country that's allowed him the opportunity to have all the success his talents can and have provided. Well, you must not be very good, you ain't in the first string quarterback, but still, they recruited you. Okay, I'd like to talk to your coach. So the bottom line is this, Colin, you're a spoiled, self-centered, little snot-nosed brat that needs to have his butt blistered. At least show some respect to the country that allows you such opportunities. And that, by the way, that multi-million-dollar piece of property that your little butt lives in. Show some respect for the men and women who have labored and died to keep our country free for you to express yourself in the way that you see fit, sir. If you will, please say thank you. Stand up and say thank you for the country that provides you the opportunity to make the damn money that you make, to live in a damn house that you get to live in, and to be able to do what you're good at. So stop disrespecting the country. And if in fact you, again, as I said earlier, it was the wrong platform, if in fact that you feel this powerful about this, step up and start writing checks.
Now we'll go to phase two of this. Because since it started, he has now changed. There are others now joining him in his protest. So he's not doing this alone. But now instead of being seated during the anthem, they are kneeling to one knee. So my thought would be if you would have thought this through in the first place. Now, to me, okay, if you're going to kneel on one knee, I can give you that one. Because, again, that's It's like, you know, the soldier kneeling at the cross. I mean, that is still a respectful piece of that. But why didn't you think about that? You know, why did it take others to say, well, instead of doing it this way, I mean, now they've kind of changed how they're doing this.
What's the point, Jimmy?
Again,
what's the point? What's the point in doing anything? It's the wrong platform. You're paid by the man. You're paid by corporations. You're taking the money from a country that you're, I say still disrespecting, but that you're protesting against. Stand the frickin' hell up. Show the respect to the flag of the United States of America and to this country, and then find another damn platform. He can get newscasters, he can get newspapers to take his interview, to give his position. Write an article, send it in. He has a platform outside of that stadium. Do it there, not in the damn stadium. The punk and any other punks that are doing it, shame on you. They're a bunch of punks.
So it still comes down to, it doesn't matter what the, you know, against the violence that's happening, again, are they, and they could be getting their point across to someone, but the, again, it comes down to if you're going to protest, but if you're, again, if you're going to protest, don't do it in a way that's going to create more problems. I mean, right or wrong.
They're adding fuel to the fire. Adding fuel to the fire. There's a better way to show your possible disgust for a situation. Did he travel to Ferguson? Did he go there and help that community? What has he done to date to change the problem other than being a little prick? Okay? What has he done to make this a better country? Look, there is no question. There is no question that we have shortcomings. I said it in that post. Mm-hmm. We have shortcomings. We are a fatally flawed group of humans. Ain't none of you out there perfect. The only person I ever knew is perfect is Jesus Christ, and you ain't it. Okay? The fact of the matter is, what is he doing to change the world? Playing football? Making $1 million, $2 million a year playing football. Again, get out there and help the people. Get your hands dirty. Go to the communities. Has he been to Louisiana? Has he been to New Orleans? Has he been down there helping any of his brothers and sisters in that neighborhood? No. No. He's standing on the sidelines of a football stadium making $2 million plus a year, bitching and moaning. Again, I'd like to hear what his mama and daddy have to say. If you'll notice, at least I haven't seen it, ain't no comment. Their silence is deafening. In my opinion, their silence is deafening.
You're listening to The Good, The Bad, and The Rooster, thanks to Debt Prodigy. Debt Prodigy helps you track all your spending and expenses, create and manage your budget, and manage all your financial account. And Debt Prodigy can show you how to get out of debt, including your home, in the shortest amount of time. DebtProdigy.com. Go there and get the details. You can sign up for more information and referred by Jimmy Olson to give Rooster and I a little bit of credit for that. Again, from the DebtProdigy.com studios, it is The Good, The Bad, and The Rooster. And yeah, so you probably just heard a little rant there from Rooster, because that's what we do here.
I'm telling you, I won't go any further. But just irritating. I'm sorry. It's just irritating. I mean, Johnny Cash did a deal that I posted on Facebook also, where he talked about his country. Mm-hmm. John Wayne did one. Several have. And he was talking about, you burn my flag, I'll kill you.
Let's talk about Johnny's protest. Johnny protested.
Sure he did.
He was the man in black.
Yep.
Why was the man in the black?
He was there for the little guy.
In fact, he wrote a song. You know, while people are downtrodden, people are being killed, whatever it is, I will always mourn this, and I will always be in black.
That's exactly why he did it.
That was his protest.
Absolutely. Absolutely. I don't have a problem with that. At every national anthem, he's standing up with his hand across it. You know it. Mm-hmm. And like you said, you burn my flag, I'll kill you. Now, he followed that up by saying, I'll kill you with kindness.
Right.
Because you do have a right. I don't agree with you, but I'm going to put my arm around you and maybe try to change your mind. I can imagine 6 foot four man putting his arm around me trying to. Johnny said, I won't change your mind, son. Yes, sir. Whatever you say. James R. Ness with Gunsmoke, 6 foot six, puts his arm around you. Yes, sir. Whatever you say.
I know we had a couple other things, but we're kind of getting to the end of our time for this week. Maybe we'll try and hit those next week. But there's just a lot of things going on. I mean, between the election nationally, what Colin's doing, but I mean, even here locally in Central Iowa with the pipeline that's coming through. Which I mean, even next week, that's still going to be conversation pieces and here's something funny though before we go too far. So if you are in the Des Moines area and you're listening to our podcast, they actually have a app now that if you see you can report a pothole. They have an app for that.
They have a whole app.
They have an app for that.
I don't know.
They have a whole app for a pothole app for that.
I like to just whole app. That was kind of cool. I'm right. Driving down the street, lost two tires in that damn hole. Let me take a picture of it and send it in so the next 2 years from now they'll fill the dadgum thing. Des Moines, you ain't very good at fixing streets. Okay, I'm just telling you.
Hey, dictionary.com came up with five words that are either mispronounced and maybe even not really used correctly. One of those, how do you say coupon?
Coupon.
Yeah, because you could repeat what I said.
Well, no, I actually would say coupon.
Would say coupon?
Yeah.
Because, a lot of them, instead of it being coupon, they're saying coupon.
I've heard that. Okay.
Which, I'll be honest.
Is there a Q on the front of that day? Yeah. But okay.
I'll admit, I was just as bad at doing that, too. I mean, it happens.
Sure.
Another one is mischievous. And we always say mischievous, but it's mischievous. But they'll say mischievous.
Yeah.
You've heard? Yeah.
Okay. I got one for you, too, when you get to it.
Reservoir.
Reservoir?
The R, the second R, but it's like reservoir, the second R, but they ignore that second R. They don't, you know, it's reservoir or whatever. Yeah.
So the R is not silent.
But it's Res-u-vor.
Res-u-vor.
Res-a-vor.
Well, where I'm from in Tennessee, we pronounce it the way that we hear it.
Well, so. you drop your R's for everything in Tennessee. Yeah. Let's see. They say prerogative, but it's prerogative.
I'd say prerogative. Yeah. So I don't say
it's
it right.
It's prerogative. P-R-U-H. So the pro rather than the per, P-E-R. And then... Espresso.
I just say espresso.
Yeah. Well, it is because there's no X in there. It is. It's espresso.
Espresso.
Yeah, but they go espresso, but it's espresso.
See, I don't get that. I don't do that. I mean, I guess there's some things that I guess it just depends on your household that you're raised in.
Mm-hmm.
I think it's how your parents. You know, I've noticed some people having a conversation. I was having a conversation with, and they use the term "I conversate." That ain't a word. I'm conversating with them. Really? What barn did you fall out of? And now, listen, I'm a hillbilly, but seriously, you know, or I love the other one, naked. I didn't know that you get naked.
Do you know? Do you say almond?
Almond.
Almond. Almond. Do you say almond? Actually, it's almond. You don't pronounce the L. It's
how
almond.
About flowers? I say, you know what I say? Flowers.
What about the thing you clean your clothes in?
Washer.
How about? Do you say sherbert?
Yeah. Sherbert.
You say? I mean, is that how you say
sherbert? Sherbert. Yeah.
Yeah. Or some say sherbet. It's actually sherbet.
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 Oh, that's stupid.
Quinoa. Quinoa.
What is quinoa?
I don't know.
You don't even know what quinoa is, so why'd you bring it up?
Because, you know.
What is it?
What's like a rice, I believe.
Quinoa is a rice?
Yeah, I think that sounds.
From where I'm from, potatoes and steak and meat's the only thing I eat.
All right, and here's our final stuff here, because we always try to, like, leave things on a happy note.
That was pretty cool. Yeah, all you folks, go back to school and learn how to talk.
All right, you like to fish, don't you?
Sure.
All right, you know. Catfish have the most senses out of any animal.
You don't say.
The most taste buds out of any animal. Catfish have the most taste buds out of any animal. Also, the highest and lowest point in the United States, the continental United States, so, you know, not Alaska or Hawaii, continental United States are both in California, not only in the same state, but the same county.
Okay.
The same county, Mount Whitney and then Badwater Basin in Death Valley. So it has the highest
and
lowest.
There, that's right. Okay. That
makes same county.
That's funny. All in the same place.
Pro athletes, because we know how Rooster loves them so much. You know that they can write off the fines that the league fines them as a tax deduction?
Whoa.
Pro athletes can write off any fines they get from their league as a tax deduction.
Well, hold on a second. Let's talk about that for a minute. Just a second. So I'm in the business of playing football. I may agree with this, by the way.
Mm-hmm.
So I'm in the business of playing football, and I had an expense that I had to take a hit because I was fined for whatever. I beat up
Coach. Yeah, whatever you did, they fined you $5,000.
So my accountant's going to take that $5,000 and deduct it from my tax return.
It would be, and you're right. Technically that would be an expense. They and that's their business. It would be a business expense.
I can't find fault in it. And the truth of the matter is, who the hell cares? $5,000 off of a $2 million yearly. Really? Seriously? Who cares?
So we talked about remakes earlier, right?
Yeah, we did.
Remember the movie Meet the Parents?
Robert De Niro.
Yeah, Robert De Niro. It was a remake. It was a remake of a small independent film from 1992, also really? Called Meet the Parents.
No kidding.
Similar plot. But yeah, it really was it was released. Few people saw it, but yeah, that was a remake.
Probably because they didn't have that many fabulous actors. You put De Niro in anything, it's like, we're going to watch De Niro.
Well, it was De Niro. And then, what was the comedian, which I can't,
Ben Stiller.
Yeah. Ben Stiller. Yeah. There you go.
His mom.
And then of course, we're thinking the wrong one. Meet the Parents, not Meet the Fockers.
Well, then who's the... Oh, Meet
oh,
the
Parents.
Oh,
no.
Meet the Fockers was the second one.
Oh, that's right. That's right. The first one was Meet the Parents, and then it was Meet the Fockers, which when they brought in Dustin Hoffman and Barbara Streisand.
That's right. Yes. That's exactly right.
Okay.
That's exactly right.
See, even we can get confused. That's the way it works. Yeah. All right, one more thing.
It's a rare occasion for me. You, it's a little different, but that's okay.
It's a rare occasion for him. For me, it happens every, 30 seconds. For him, it's every 60.
There you go. See, I last longer. That's another subject you get on. I really do. All right.
Here we go. Last one.
We want the kids to be able to listen to this.
All right. The USDA regulates the fruit breakdown in fruit cocktail.
They regulate. It means how many pieces of peach and how many pieces of cucumber. Or not
it
cucumber.
Must be cucumber.
Whatever. Sorry.
Is that cucumber or cucumber?
Cucumber. speaking of which, can I talk to those guys? Because there needs to be more cherries. There's never enough cherries in it.
So 30 to 50% should be diced peaches. 25 to 45% diced pears. 6 to 16% diced pineapple.
That's what I was looking for, pineapple.
6 to 20% grapes, whole grapes, and then a few cherries.
Yeah, you people are screwed up. More cherries, okay? But here's the thing. Why am I tax dollars paying on regulating what goes into a fruit freaking cocktail? Believe it or not, I read 20 years ago about a report. This guy submitted his paperwork to get a fund set up to do a test.
Mm-hmm.
Government paid him, I think it was maybe $50,000, 20, 30 years ago. You know what he was trying to find out?
What?
How fast ketchup flows downhill. So he'd take the Heinz bottle, a little trough, how fast does it go down there? You got $50,000 to figure that out. I figure we're worth $100,000 to figure out where the hell this show's going.
Oh, trust me. I said if I could get paid for what I mean, there was one that they figured that how much time you spent eating per day. That was a study.
That's nuts.
That was a study. There was also a study about what you do when you eat, talking, lunch, things
no
like that.
Kidding. Yeah. No kidding.
All right.
That's crazy. Man, we could go to we could do another hour just on that subject.
Absolutely. Maybe next week.
There you go.
All right. Thank you. We are listening to you are listening to The Good, the Bad, and the Rooster. Thanks to Debt Prodigy, the world's first interactive web-based financial tool that virtually puts your home and business finances on autopilot. Go to debtprodigy.com for details. In fact, you can fill out the form and they'll be sure to give you all the details that will keep you up to date on how that's all going and make a reference in there to Jimmy Olsen. So Rooster and I get credit for that. Thank you very much for listening. Thank you for joining me, Rooster.
Glad to be here, brother. I'll be here next week if you let me.
Absolutely. And we will chat then. So from the debtprodigy.com studios, it's The Good, the Bad, and the Rooster.